Listening Library presents Team Human by Justine Larbalestier and Sarah Rees Brennan. Read for you by Julia Whelan. Chapter 1. Two Girls and a Hazmat Suit. I wasn't feeling very enthused about education the day the vampire came to school. Usually, since we live in Maine, it's cold. This September, the sun was invading the sky, bright and fierce, and my best friend, Cathy, and I were hauling our bags up one of the steep streets and sweating. I was also not feeling very enthused about vampires, but I never am. Cathy is a different matter. If there was a box for vampirologist on one of our career goals questionnaires, and there isn't, you can be a psychiatrist for vampires, or a donor to vampires, or an academic in vampire studies, but I just made up that word to mean a big fan of the undead, Cathy would check it every time. Don't get me wrong, Cathy's not stupid. She's really smart. Without her encouraging me, I wouldn't be doing AP English and History. She's a dreamer. You know the type. Reads poetry by the bucket load. Keats, Plath, Chatterton. Gets so into books she walks into walls. Gets so into telling me a story she walks right into traffic and I have to grab her and yank her back to safety. She likes history more than the news and likes books better than most people. Of course, she thinks vampires, since many of them are older than dirt and thus basically history books with legs and fangs, are totally fascinating. So naturally, when we looked across the street and saw the figure in the bulky black suit and helmet, like a cross between Darth Vader and an astronaut, Cathy's eyes lit right up. Because broad daylight plus person in weird suit must equal vampire. This in spite of the fact that very few vampires seem inclined to go into the sun in a protective suit when a single pinprick to a sleeve would kill them. Let's put it this way. I'm a born and bred new Whitby girl, and I've seen a vampire in a suit exactly once, and it was on the news.
Maybe he's a vampire, she said, inclining her head.
Cathy's too much of a lady to point at people. I'm not much of a lady, personally, so I stared pretty openly. I wasn't the only one. Or maybe there's been a chemical explosion and that's the member of the hazmat team who drew the short straw, I said. We both looked ahead at the school. Cranston High stood there like always, red brick and very solid, no flames billowing from the bay windows. Alternate theory, I said as we crossed the road and headed in, a little ahead of the mystery suit. He's the keenest scuba diver in the world. Cathy returned her gaze to the possible scuba diver and took a little wistful breath. Not quite a sigh, but sort of bracing herself for her latest daydream not to be true.
He could be a vampire.
Yeah, I can see it, I said. He moves with the predatory grace of a penguin. Cathy bit back a smile so she wouldn't hurt the scuba diver's feelings. Too nice for her own good, that girl. She even held open the door so he could penguin shuffle his hazmat butt into the school. He inclined his big black helmet to her as he passed by and advanced into the dark hall. Then he slid off the helmet, and I saw he was graceful after all. The movement was the way you'd imagine a knight in a fairy tale would remove his helm. He had the kind of looks that made normal, sensible thoughts turn into stupid poetry. Hair like sunlight trapped in shadows, and eyes that were an insane cornflower blue. A face like a sculpture on a tomb, all clean, white, perfect lines. A dead person's face. The vampire turned those eyes on Cathy, who stood rooted to the spot and squinted.
Could you possibly shut the door?
he asked in a low, cool voice.
It is rather bright.
You probably have the wrong idea about where I live. New Whitby, the vampire city. It's really not as weird as people think. It's like Las Vegas. I'm sure people who actually live in Las Vegas hardly ever play slot machines or have Elvis impersonators perform their weddings. Lots of other places were founded by people escaping persecution because of their religion. New Whitby was founded by people escaping persecution because they were the blood-drinking undead. We're not all vampires, and we don't all want to be vampires. When our career guidance teacher asked us to make lists of professions we were interested in, vampire was not on mine. I know vampire isn't technically a profession, but seriously, you should see the ones around here. They're pros at it. Being a vampire is their job. Vampires have long-term investments, of course, and modeling careers. The camera loves Ludmilla Vaughn doesn't need airbrushing. That's part of what I think makes vampires so boring. Once you're a vampire, you don't ever need to be anything else. New Whitby is not only a vampire city. It never was. Plenty of humans came too. People who had vampires in the family and people who didn't. People who just arrived here and stayed. My mom's family came over from China to America because of the railroads, moved across America selling stuff to the gold miners, and settled here. You wind up where you wind up, and no place in the world is perfect. There's always something to cope with. Too hot, too cold, no nightlife. In our city's case, it's way too much nightlife. With fangs. But like I said, it's not such a big deal. There are blood banks and donors these days. You're more likely to be killed in a plane crash than drained by a vampire, even if you live in New Whitby. There are a ton of restrictions on making vampires now, too, so most people living here don't have vampires in the family. Except for a few vampire ancestors some people inherited, like antique chairs or the family silver, or my biology partner Laura's crazy Aya, or my friend Ty's Aunt Sabine, who only comes over to his house on the holidays. She gives truly excellent presents. So, sure, at night you'll pass a vampire here and there. Occasionally you'll find yourself sitting next to one at the movies. You'll see vampire cops walking their beats. There's an all-vampire division, since human cops faced with vampire criminals are at a bit of a disadvantage. As you may have noticed, I'm not crazy about vampires. I always thought they were a bit creepy. On top of the whole blood-drinking thing, they don't have human feelings. And after what happened to my friend Anna this summer, I'm even less keen on them. But vampires tend to keep to the shade quarter, and the tourists have to go there to goggle at them. New Whitby is a city like any other, except this one's mine, stretching up steeply from the harbor where the nightshade came in 300 years ago to the high smoked glass towers gleaming in the sun beside the spikes and slopes of Victorian buildings. The school's doors were also made of smoked glass. The anti-discrimination regulations mean that it's the same in all buildings throughout the city. Vampire-killing UV rays must be kept out. Cathy shut the door with such a loud bang I jumped. But when I turned to my best friend, I saw that she hadn't taken her eyes off the vampire. She was staring at him as if Richard the Lionheart had arrived at her house for tea, as if a miracle had happened.
I'm sorry, she said. For the noise, I mean.
Think nothing of it, the vampire murmured.
Hey, my name's Mel Dewan, I announced in an attempt to break Cathy out of her blissful vampire-induced daze. Is there something I can do for you? Can we point you to the principal's office? I bet you want to be on your way as soon as possible, huh? I have never received any compliments on my subtlety.
I am not anxious to leave, the vampire said. In fact, I have been fortunate enough to be accepted as a student in this fine center of learning. But I thank you for your offer of assistance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.